must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. Well, today is episode 233, Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. Is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called Debt, Your Obligations to Others, with guest Johnnie Lloyd. Tune in here, Steve and Johnnie continue their series, Right Thinking, Life, Money, Relationships, this week discussing how we all have obligations to others, but do we manage them toward having value in our lives, or are we controlled by them? Well, Johnnie, thanks for doing another show with me.
It's a pleasure to be here. I'm excited about this topic as we continue to move forward, especially during this season that all of us are in. We are shifting and moving and gathering and having opportunities for greater harvest. So I'm excited about today.
You know, Johnnie, a lot of people that I'm in contact with, I'm noticing that they're starting to get more enrichment out of their lives. They're not running around as much as they used to, looking for something to do, something to spend their money on. I've really noticed that people are getting more in touch with their own personal values and goals, I believe. I think that's one of the side effects of the pandemic, is that people have been isolated. They couldn't go to the movie theaters or go to sports events as much as they might have used to, et cetera. And so I'm seeing a change. And I think it's a wonderful time for what we're doing to try to enrich their lives with teaching them how to manage their personal affairs, specifically as it relates to their financial involvements, because I think that can help a lot of people. So I'm so glad to be sharing the platform, the microphone with you. Well, Johnnie, last week, I really enjoyed our approach to the way we spoke about credit last week. I went back and listened to the four or five episodes on my radio show that I had already done on credit with some very wonderful guests that are experts in the field. And I feel like we did a pretty good job. Now, if anybody disagrees, you know, like, come on, Steve, you didn't do that good. Quit saying that. Anyway, just get in touch with us because we want to add more. Our goal is to be complete so that we don't leave any of the fundamentals of the basics out. At the very end of the show, we tried to finish up what I had said I was going to do earlier in the show, which is so important, about the credit card trap. And so, Johnnie, I want to just go right into finishing up what I call the credit card trap, because today's show is going to be on debt, and the credit card trap is the bridge to people falling into the water off the bridge and having to tread water for a long time, and we don't want people to sink. So let me talk about the credit card trap and get some thoughts from you after I speak to it, if that's okay.
Perfect.
Okay. Well, there's a little high school girl, and she loves costume jewelry. She actually has one of those trees on her dresser that can hold up to 60 or 70 pairs of earrings. She loves earrings. You know, there's a lot of people out there that are really fashion hawks out there that are making fashion statements that love all these earrings. And you know, Johnnie, what I think is kind of sad about it, I mean, I think it's wonderful that people are fashion, you know, get into fashion. Sure, that's one of their choices. And if that's what makes them happy and have a better outlook on life, go for it. I mean, we all like to dress and enjoy the colors that we wear, the types of clothes. I mean, everybody's got their own statement. I think it's wonderful. We need to have that individual personality. But what we don't want to do is get caught up in something that doesn't end up having any value toward who we are and where we're going, and end up in serious financial trouble because of something that we're doing that really we get caught up in. I think I'll just use that word. We get caught up in it. So this little high school girl, she She's working at Busch Gardens. That's in Williamsburg, Virginia. There's a couple of them in the country. And it's a summer job. And, you know, she's only making right around minimum wage. And just for this example, I don't remember what it is now, but $7 an hour is what she makes per hour. And I want to lay out the variables here. It takes her an hour to get to work each day. So she has 2 hours invested in just the travel time, the gas that she spends to get to work. And when she gets to work in the summertime, she works at a station where she scoops ice cream. She's an ice cream scooper. Some days she fills in and does sodas for people because, you know, she's just working like at a little kiosk type thing where she's doing ice cream or drink. There's days over in Busch Gardens where it gets 100 degrees, high 90s all the time in July, early August, you know, and it's brutally hot over there. And she generally works a 4 hour shift. Okay, so let's sort of add that up. 2 hours round trip, 4 hours there. So it's 6 hours to do 4 hours. Okay, well, let's go back to her thing. She's a fashion statement, and she's got some girlfriends, and they're high school, and they like to go hang out at the mall, especially when other people that they know are going to be there. And so what I didn't tell you is this little girl, she actually just graduated high school, makes it easier because last week I said, how do you get a credit card? Just open your mailbox. You know, they're just trying to inundate you with giving you a credit card. Use our credit. Starts off $250, $300. So she's got a credit card now. And she just graduated high school, got a credit card. She's got a summer job. One of her girlfriends, actually two of her girlfriends come by. It's got a car. Says, come on, let's go. Let's go to the mall and hang out for a couple hours. Well, this little girl is responsible. She's working. She's doing good. And it's the very last day that she can make her monthly payment on her credit card. And if she doesn't make her payment tonight, she's going to be late in getting her payment posted. And there's going to be a late charge of $35. Now, to go back a little bit, she's got like 60 pairs of earrings already on this little tree on her dresser, and probably most of them she's never even worn yet. They're still kind of like in some kind of packaging. Well, she had bought a pair of earrings on her credit card for $5 at one of the stores she goes to a couple of weeks earlier. She charged it on her credit card the month before, actually, to get the timing straight. And she got a bill on her credit card for the $5 pair of earrings from the cycle before. So, you know, we pointed out last week that if you charge something on your credit card and you pay it off when the bill comes in, it doesn't cost anything. It's just a use of handling your money. I don't want to carry cash around, so I use a credit card. And we're getting to the cashless society phase of life, and you need a credit card sometimes. And so she bought a pair of credit cards. She bought a pair of earrings for $5 on her credit card. The bill came in, and the bill's been sitting there ready to be paid. Tonight's the last night that she realizes, I better pay it or I'm going to be late. Her two friends come over. They come in her room, and they're all giddy and laughing and saying, let's go to the mall because the guys that we are kind of talking about a whole lot, we know they're going to be there for a little while. So, you know, it's a whole social scene. She goes, I can't go right now because I'm getting ready to go online and pay my credit card bill. Oh, do it when you get back. We're only going to be there for 2 hours. So, yeah, she gets talked into it because they say you'll be home by 8 or 9. You'll have plenty of time to still pay it. So we got to go now, though. So she goes. She gets home at about 9:30, not much after they said, but she completely forgets about going online and paying that $5 balance on her credit card. She gets her next credit card bill. She's got a $35 late charge. So that $5 pair of earrings is now up to $40 that it's costing her that she didn't need in the first place. Now, let me give you what I'm going to tell you. She makes $6 an hour net, just $7 wages, takes out taxes, Social Security on it. So let's just call it $6 that she clears. She works in 100-degree weather, pumping sodas or scooping ice cream at Busch Gardens, gives up commute time, and she's got to work a minimum of 6 hours, but she only works 4 hour shifts. So she's working a shift and a half to go to Busch Gardens to get paid to pay for those earrings that now cost her $40. Now, that is an example of what I call the credit card trap, where this young lady, because she wasn't disciplined enough to pay that credit card bill on time, she is a slave to the credit card company, because she is literally working, standing on her feet, giving up her time for something that didn't have much value in the first place. But even if it had value, that $35 is costing her 6 hours of her life to be able to pay. It's totally working for the credit card company. That's just my example that I wanted to give to illustrate the credit card trap. Does it have value what you did? Are you disciplined to meet the terms that you're supposed to? But ultimately, I just want people to realize that if you're using credit cards to buy things that you can't really afford, and there's times, emergencies, you got to get your car fixed, you're going to pay it out over the next cycle or two. Okay, fine. Pay a little bit of interest. That little bit of interest is nothing compared to that $35 charge for the lack of discipline to pay your bill on time. So Johnnie, I don't think I need to analyze it any further. What's your thoughts on my little story that I just shared?
The key things for the story is every decision matters for me. Every decision, right? The system is set up in such a way that it's not just about the interest rate, it's about late fees. The late fees actually are higher than the interest rate. So if you know that you are sometimes forgetful to making your payments, then you might want to set it up on automatic pay, especially if you use your credit card all the time. So it's not really the credit card that's the issue. It's the individual. Because just because something is set up to fight against you, to cause you to be in debt, to cause you to be enslaved to a system, you're only enslaved when you enter in and you align yourself to the issues, the problems that come in the system. The problem is not the earrings. The problem was not her salary, even though I have issues with all of that. We could talk about that. But the real issue was she didn't handle her business. She didn't handle it. So the issue is when we don't handle our commitments, our obligations, when we don't do what we say, and it relates back to Steve's book, is from the lips to the hip is a pretty far distance. However, it's a really close distance when your lips and your hip don't say the same thing. Her hip said, let's get the earrings and let's go play and enjoy. And I got that. She's young. However, the lip said to the credit card company that you're going to pay me. And if you miss a payment, then the fee is $35. So they're doing what they said they were going to do, right? However, the disconnect is she did not fulfill the obligation, and that $5 cost her $35 extra dollars. And if you look at it from that perspective, not just did she work another day plus to get it, she also lost the opportunity to spend her own $35. So that opportunity cost, right? She could have bought 5 more sets of earrings had she did what she said she's going to do. Not that I'm saying buy 5 more sets of earrings, because like Steve said, she probably did. You got 60 on there. Maybe you don't need any, but that's a whole different issue. But you now are giving for the privilege of borrowing somebody's $5, the bank's $5, which you had available to you to pay back, just cost you an extra $35. So it's not the bank. is us. We have to make the decision to not be, I'm going to call it enslaved, or not be bound by a system that was created to generate income for the company because of our decision making. That is where the decision matters. That is where you, we all get a chance to say, volunteer to go in, or volunteer to say, nah, I'm not going to do that because this is not worth it to me. I want to do something else with my money, or I need something else. So that's what I would say, Steve. So all of those things, you, the story that you provided, the scenario that you provided has a lot of ebbs and flows in it. I mean, we could talk about the fact of how much money she's making. We could talk about the fact that she's going 2 hours. So it's not just the hours that she's at the job. It's really the 2 hours in addition for commuting, and how much does it cost her to commute? So are you even, you know, there's a lot of dynamics in that. However, the biggest dynamic to stay on the debt piece is the obligation versus and responsibility. Because with the obligation comes our responsibility to meet the obligation that we agreed to. And there is a penalty anytime we don't meet an obligation that we have assigned to, whether that's be a personal penalty, a relational penalty, a financial penalty, an emotional penalty, a professional penalty. When you don't do what you say, there is always a ramification from it. That's the deal. So that's what I would say, Steve.
You said a lot, and I like what you said. You know, Johnnie, let's go back. I'm a very simple person. I like to keep it to the basics. The whole purpose of right thinking that we're doing life, money, relationships is to try to help people have a better life. And there's many different components of that. If everything's going nice, they're not feeling a lot of pressure, they're not having debt collectors calling them on the phone all the time, they're able to meet their budget, they're able to buy the birthday gifts for the kids that they want, they're able to eat properly, they're able to pay for their medical insurance. And what, you know, in other words, if they're able to live the way that they would like to live, that they've thought about, that's good, healthy, moving their life forward, clean, whatever you want to describe it, managing their lives, being disciplined requires being focused and knowing what you want. And we can, this is kind of like a circle here. You know, we're into the trenches now with credit and debt. But really, let's pull out of it for a minute and go back to what is it we're trying to do in the first place. And that is to teach people that if you know how to manage your finances, your money and your finances well, you're going to reach more goals in your life and you're going to have a better life. And that's what our little niche is to help people manage their money to have a better life. Now, you said it right there when you analyzed it. If she wanted to, she has the right to. We're not telling people what their choices are. We're telling them to get to where you can make the choices that you want and have that freedom. And so what we've really talked about in this example that I brought up, this little anecdote, story, illustration, is the difference between being enslaved and having freedom of choice. And so, you know, if she wanted to buy 5 more pairs of earrings, like you said, she might not have needed them, but that's her choice, not ours. You know, she's not ready yet to start putting the money aside for something that's a bigger goal. She'll get to that later when she starts looking at her money and realizing, you know, if I only had 50 pairs of earrings, I could take the money I spent on that other 10 and start to plan that little travel vacation with my friends down to, I don't know where they go now. Where, you know, it used to be Daytona Beach and all that other kind of stuff years ago. But so that's the substitution principle. So what we're talking about is all connected together. Now, what I would like to get into now, are you satisfied, Johnnie, that the credit trap that we said we were going to talk about has been talked about enough? You think we've covered it okay?
actually think that we have tapped into the surface. It is deeper. And then that gives people an opportunity to reach out to us if they have or need additional information, because it becomes very specific to a people or a group to discuss other things from this point forward. So I think we have covered it well enough for what we, you know, just to, let's call it encouraging people to understand the overarching view of how they are really in control of their thoughts and coming out of debt or the debt trap. Yes, I think we've covered it.
Good, yeah. So everybody, we just encourage you, like Johnnie just said, to take a look at how you are doing things. And it may be as simple as make sure that you set aside a certain time of the month to pay your bills on time, knowing when the due dates are so you don't pay them late. That's all. Because the biggest part of credit is how you pay your bills timely. I think that's your history. 35% of your score is, are you a late pay? Do you pay on time? So get that part in your life straightened out. And, you know, Johnnie, another thing is, I would assume that most of the people that are listening to us that are trying to get something out of what our message is, they're probably listening to it more so that they can help encourage others that they care and love about to help their situation, because I'm going to give a compliment to our listeners. I bet that most of you are on top of your financial situation and doing very good, and you're listening to Johnnie and I because you want to fine-tune it a little bit. But if you're one of these people that, you know, you're working, but your money doesn't seem to ever get you anywhere and you're spinning your wheels, pay attention to this little story and see if you can broaden it to take a look at the way you do things and see how much money you may be wasting that you can channel into a different direction. So that's my summary of how the credit card trap fits into overall financial management. Johnnie, today we're talking about debt. And when I wrote the announcement to the show, I said, we all have obligations to others. I mean, the name of the, I titled it Debt, Your Obligations to Others. I played with that title a little bit. You know, we have commitments and we have obligations. And, you know, no man is an island. We're all in this together. But I'm talking about obligations. And I will say this, and then I would like for you to write a thesis on it for us today. Speak a thesis on it, because we're radio, not book. Johnnie, I believe that commitments are wonderful. We have to make commitments. People need to depend on us. We say we're going to do something. We need to fulfill it. Obligations are very closely related to commitments, but I think they might be different. So the question that I would like you to include the answer to when you speak on this is, I think that some obligations that are of choice can be very, very good, but some obligations that we fall into that we wish we didn't have to be locked into could be very detrimental to our well-being. What's your thoughts on your obligations to others that ends up in debt?
Wow, that's a deep well. Can I say that? That's a deep well. Okay, so obligations. When we talk about obligations, we are there's different types, right? You just alluded to that. So let's talk about the obligation when you signed a contract and you say you're going to do something in exchange for what they're going to provide you. A credit card company is going to provide you a credit limit or a line of credit that you can swipe your card against in response for you paying the bill. That's an obligation, or you're committing. That's an obligation. Where the commitment comes in is you taking your future income and committing it to pay back that obligation that you made. That's if you can look at the two. Again, the obligation is the legal or the signed document that you're in exchange for this. A, if you do A, then you get an opportunity to do B. That's the obligation. You sign the dotted line saying you're going to do that, right? So you are obligated to do that. And it may be a legal obligation, even in marriage, you know, or even in relationship or whatever. You are obligated. You have on your own ability, you have decided that you're going to say yes to this. Nobody tied you up. Nobody beat you. Nobody did anything negative to you to make you say yes to that. So you looked at the opportunity and said, yes, that's the, and so you are obligated to meet the requirements that, or the legal contract or the agreement that you have set aside, even if it wasn't signed. It could be verbal agreement, right? So let's go back to commitment. The commitment is actually doing what you obligated, what you said you were going to do. The commitment is looking at your life and saying, okay, I said I was going to do A. They met their part of the bargain. Now I'm going to commit future resources to repay or to do what I said I was going to do to align my life, my budget, my well-being to ensure that I meet the obligation I signed up to. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay. So that is the key. The key is that, you know, people have, I'm going to call it, they have limited recall when it comes to aligning to things that they are obligated to when it comes to, you know, like when the paycheck, it's easy to say yes, that I'm going to pay you back when the paycheck hasn't come in, when I'm buying the thing I want. When she's buying the $5 earrings, it is easy to say I'm going to repay the credit card company, right? But when she has to commit her time, her energy, and to literally take the money out of her account and pay it, it's not that it doesn't exist, is that then other things have popped up. Because remember, it's your future. You're gonna repay it in the future. So that's what sometimes happens to people, is that life happens between the obligation, you receiving what you want, let's say buying a car, you receive what you want, right? Then when you start making those monthly installments, it's like you have to be committed to do that because other things happen. Sometimes the car breaks down. You say, I don't want to pay for it. No, you're still obligated to do what you said. And that's why the FICO score, or, you know, the score that you have for your FICO score makes a difference. When you look at that part of it, and I believe it is right spot on, that 35% of building your FICO score is actually built on you following through with your commitments. What is your payment history? Isn't that where we look at people and say, okay, based on the way that you have responded to me in the past, I can trust you now with this. That's all they're saying. They're saying based on how you have responded in the past to other people, to other situations, because it's not always easy to align yourself or to set aside the resources to go ahead and meet your obligation, but it's a matter of your character. That's what we talked about, right? It's a matter of your character. It's a matter of your integrity. It's a matter of all those things, because absolutely most people would love to build debt on one side and never pay for it. But that's not acceptable. I mean, people have done it, and I understand there's things that can happen and people do that. However, what does your word look like? I'm going to do one more step and I'm going to hand it back to you, Steve. If you were in a relationship with someone and every time they said they were going to do something, they didn't do it, would you, the next thing, at some point, you would look at them and say, you know, you said it, but I know you're not going to do it, because based on past history, you haven't done it. That's all we're talking about. So if I say I'm going to do something, like there was a situation that happened to me yesterday. I was headed to my girlfriend's wedding, her daughter's wedding, actually. There was a lot of dynamics, but on the way, there was just no way I was going to get there in time. And some other things happened. And so I texted her. I sent her a video and told her how sorry I was that I was not going to celebrate this time with her. That it was not, it, something came up, something happened. Well, it rained, I left late, you know, the traffic was horrible. None of those things I could control. Same thing with you. You obligated yourself, right? And yeah, something happened in your life, you know, you had an extra bill you didn't know about. So then you have to be the person of your word to go back to the person you said you had the obligation to and let them know that you're not going to be there. You're not able to do it right now. How can you fix this? Because you value the relationship, whether it be with a financial institution or with someone that you care about, or you're building a relationship with, or your job, whatever. Okay? You have to go back and say that it doesn't look good. You don't wait until you've missed this expense and then say, I guess they figured it out because it didn't show up. No. Just go back. Stand up and do what you say you're going to do. And when you find out you can't, be the same person that you were when you said you were going to do it, and go back and say, I know this is what I told you. How can we rework it? Or this is where I am right now. And I think that that causes people to be able to work with you. But more than anything, it causes you to build trust for you and to remember how important obligating your time, your resources, your talent, all of that matters. Okay. So Steve, I know I said a lot.
Oh, no, I like listening to you, Johnnie. Thank you. Johnnie, you brought up just kind of a major illustration. The two main things with having good credit, because that's really what we've been trying to talk about. Credit and debt go hand in hand here, hand in glove. The two main components that will help you have good credit is your credit payment history and your ability to communicate to your creditors. Because your creditors will help you if you communicate upfront with them. But one of the third major things that makes for good credit, and this is one of the main components of the score, I think it's 18%, give or take. It's the length that you've maintained your credit. That's a very important thing. And in other words, credit's not the kind of thing that you decide you're going to go from saving all your money under your pillow because you found out that you didn't know, well, I can't get a mortgage to buy that house without having established credit for over a period of time. I'm going to refinance right now. As a matter of fact, it's a good time to refinance. And, you know, my income is being averaged over the last 2 years. Even, you know, in other words, you gotta be able, they look at things like, if your income is on a decline, when they average it, that's good. But if I'm all of a sudden got a job, that not me, but if a person gets a good job all of a sudden and they've had it for 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, maybe, and they go, oh, good, I'm making enough money now to go buy a house and have a mortgage payment at a certain level. When they go to apply, they go back 2 years, the mortgage company, when they look at your ability to get approved for this mortgage. And if your income was real low for the last 18 months, but all of a sudden you finally got stabilized and got a good job, it might be too soon for them to believe that you're going to be able to make the payment because your history hasn't been out there long enough. So a real easy example to tell you, if you've got credit cards that you don't use anymore, that you've had for a number of years, if there's not a fee attached to them to carry that's costing you something, keep those credit cards. you might occasionally want to buy a $5 pair of earrings or an ice cream cone to show that there's a little activity so that the card's not completely inactive. But my point is, the length of time that you've demonstrated that you're a person of your word is one of the major things to have good credit. So when people are wanting to know how to rebuild their credit or establish credit, you start now. You can change it, but it's going to take time and you need to be patient. So to move on now. So when life gets in the way and circumstances come up that are unexpected and your financial picture gets very difficult and you believe maybe to no reason that I've created, just circumstances, that car accident didn't help my finances, the divorce crushed my finances, whatever your personal story is, sometimes you have a very difficult time meeting your obligations, things that you've committed to. And so what do you do when it gets hard like that? Well, on today's show, again, when I'm thinking about the title, I came up with what I was thinking about using, but it was too long and it's got a lot of other things to think about. But listen to this definition that I, the title that I was going to kind of build the definition in. Debt. Something that you incur when you can't afford to buy it from your current situation. Now, you can't afford to buy a house with cash. Most people can't. I mean, if you can't afford to buy a house with cash, you're very well off and you're just going to move one investment to another and say, I'd rather pay cash for it. There are some very wealthy people that just have gotten to where they just pay cash for things because they don't want to incur a payment to a company where they're making money. You know, if you buy a house on the average, you're going to pay approximately three times what the price of that house is over a 30-year mortgage. So if you buy a $200,000 house, your payments are going to be close to $600,000 over 30 years. If you can find some way to pay it down quicker, make extra payments if you want to, whatever. Sure, there's a lot of things that we can do here. But what I'm getting at is, in our world, it's very hard to buy things or have things like a car. There's not very many young people that want to buy a new car that can afford to pay for the car without financing the car. You need credit to finance the car. You need good credit to get the lowest rate. So what happens, though, when a person's circumstances get difficult and they have to go in debt? That's the phrase, go in debt. It means I can't afford it, but I got to do it. I got to pay these medical bills. I got to finance this or that. So you use credit. It could be a bank loan or whatever. So we're going to talk pretty much about how credit works in terms of loans. By the way, the definition that you gave was right on, spot on. A banker that's a career banker, retired, very close friend of mine, Don Price, on the board of my foundation, he said that credit is a legally binding contract between a borrower, in which case a borrower accepts something of value and in return agrees to pay the lender that amount with consideration. In this case, the consideration is interest. So it's an obligation, but it's legal. And you know, the credit card trap we talked about, you have complete control of whether or not they win the game against you. And most people kind of succumb to it. They can't play by the rules properly and it costs them a lot of money. And there's a lot of sacrifice of not having what you want because you didn't, you know, you got stuck. You pay on a credit card bill sometimes and the principal never goes down because you don't have enough money to pay the balance off like you should have. And it just sits out there and sits out there and sits out there. Now, when you're in that situation where you got a lot of bills and they get caught up with you, you know, your intentions to pay the bill on time didn't happen. I want to give you a little scenario here that teaches what I think is the single best way to rebuild your credit and move yourself forward when you feel like you can't do anything about it. It's debt consolidation. Now, debt consolidation means if you've got a lot of small bills out there what you want to do is you want to get rid of a lot of small bills because they're pulling your credit down if you haven't paid them on time and they've been reported to the credit agencies. And so a very simple example that I want to give you that I teach, let's say you've got 10 creditors out there and you fell on hard times, you're out of work because of surgery or something, you missed a couple months of work and now you're all behind and you're doing your very best to have payment plans, you've communicated, and you've got 10, very simple example, it's a theoretical, hypothetical here, you've got 10 creditors that you call up, just like Steve and Johnnie show you how to do. And you set up a payment plan that's the very best that they will accept. Each one of these 10 creditors that you owe $500 to, you owe $5,000 total. It's going to hurt your credit if they report you to the credit agencies. It's going to pull your credit way down. You don't want that to happen. The secret is, when you're having hard times, maintain your credit. So you call each one of them up and you use the Steve Johnnie method of setting up a payment plan, and you come out of it with $100 a month for 5 months. And you're really good at it, and it didn't mean $100 today. You actually got 5 months. A month from the day, I'll pay you $100. I don't have the money today. They're okay to accept that. So you're on 10 $100 a month payment plans. Now, 10 $100 a month is $1,000 a month for 5 months. You're going to pay $5,000. Well, you do your cash flow budget, you do your projections that you've learned from Johnnie and Steve, and you can't make 10 payments of $100 a month. It's too much, but you felt that you had to accept it. If you didn't start that $100 a month payment next month, you got them away from today, but they gave you that first month. They're going to report you to the credit agency for being late paid because you've already been a couple months late and they're getting ready to send it to the credit people for collections. Well, you decide, okay, I'm going to get a part-time job because I want my credit to be good and I want to get out of debt. So you're working full-time already. You get a part-time job. And I'm just going to tell you, if you're working 60 hours a week, or maybe you already work 50 for your regular job, and you put that much stress and pressure on yourself, it's a really good chance that something may go wrong and you might not be able to keep your payments made the way that you intend it to do. Your intentions are really good. I'm going to work really hard for 5 months and I'm going to be in a better position. Well, it's inevitable that something's going to happen and you're going to skip a couple payments with a couple of your creditors. And then you don't have a second chance. They're tired of you. They just don't even call you. They just send it right on to collections. Your credit's going to be impacted negatively because you didn't do what you said you were going to do. So what's the answer to that is, before your credit goes much lower, get a consolidation loan. And on this case, I know you want to get out of your debts as fast as possible, but sometimes you can't work that hard. It's too hard on yourself, working all that extra hours. So my suggestion is, if you go to a bank and you get a $5,000 loan to pay off all 10 of them in one day, a $5,000 loan for 24 months, 2 years, at 10%, and that's way higher than what you ought to be paying, but if you got credit that's iffy, they might charge you 10%. The payment is $230.72 a month. Now think about it. You're saving almost $270 a month on killing yourself to get them all paid in 5 months. And so instead of having to get that extra job, you can just not even get an extra job. You've got all these bills paid off. Your credit is improved immediately because you don't have 10 little bills floating around anymore. There's no risk that you're going to be late paying any of them when you're stressing to try to fight to work that hard to get them paid. And at the end of the 2 years, all of them are paid off, assuming that you've learned your lesson, or not so much learned a lesson. I apologize for that statement. Some people will learn a lesson because they got themselves into all these little debts by not being focused, doing things they didn't need to do. But for the person that I'm giving the example that you're, you know, you're a good, honorable person. You're trying to do the best you can. You had a hardship sidetracked you. You want to keep your credit straight. You get a consolidation loan. You're banking $270 a month from what you would have done if you were working that extra money. But you could probably absorb $230 a month by tightening down on other areas and not kill yourself in the process. Get a better attitude. Be smart and be relaxed. And at the end of 2 years, the debt's paid off. You can pay it off sooner if you do well. But you don't have to put yourself into that stressful situation. But you've improved your credit. Johnnie, what do you think about that initial start for consolidation?
While you were talking, because you know how we do, we think of all the things that the other person is saying, just to add some more information. The thing that I would like to identify is this. Some people that do debt consolidation then have excess, like Steve gave the amount of, now you have $270. When you do the debt consolidation and you pay the loan that is set up for $5,000, all those little payments, you have to the bottom line of your budget, you have a gain of $270, right? Now, I don't want you to miss what he said. He said, put it away. See, what happens with a lot of us when we get, whether it be an opportunity like debt consolidation or we get a raise or something, we don't tell our money where to go. Because money doesn't have a mind, so we have to give it purpose, right? So of that 270, we're using the same example to just elevate it another level, is think about the 270. So the 270 would either consider it going into the emergency fund we've talked about in previous episodes, consider taking half of it and putting it in an emergency fund and taking half of it and paying the loan off early. Or, and these are just options, take half of it, put it in an emergency fund, because the deal with an emergency fund is it's set up in such a way that the money is available when there's an emergency that you have identified in advance. That does not mean sale. That doesn't mean that. Okay, an emergency identified in advance, so you don't have to go back to a credit card, right? So you want to look at that. Now, the other possibility is to take the money and do something else with it, but do something with the money. Identify how you can be better off and that your credit score will even grow from that. And when I say grow, I'm saying increase, because Steve already said with the consolidation, normally there's an increase because you got rid of a lot of small debt. However, the other thing that happens is based on how long you've had the small debt, it could cause your score to drop, because you could have something on there that you've had for 10 years, open account, now is closed. So that your length of the time that you've had credit may change. Don't worry about don't let your score be the driver, the only driver. Let your budget be the driver. Let the fact that you're building wealth, that you have a plan. So what I tell people who are considering debt or loan consolidation is, what are you going to do with the resources? Number one, what are you going to do with now the resource that you have in your bottom line? When I say bottom line, I'm saying your budget. What are you going to do with that? How are you going to be better tomorrow than you are today? Because if you don't make a plan, what will happen is that $270 will just kind of disappear every month. It'll go away on things, you know, like, wow, I got extra money, and you'll start spending it. So give it a plan so that you do that. I was with a client a few days ago, and what I told them to do is put a savings account as in one of the bills, because they have an issue and they don't save. They have the resources, but they don't save. So I said, make it a bill. Make it an automatic withdrawal every month. They said, no. I said, no, make it a bill. You pay your bills extremely well. Make your savings account, which is in this case an emergency fund, make it a bill. So pay yourself. Take a portion of it and pay yourself. Take a portion of it and invest it in your future, whether it be emergency fund or whatever, to increase your bottom line. So just consider that, because it's really important. And the other thing, it's just when you know your numbers, when you know your numbers, you're better off. You make better decisions. Let me say that. When you know what's in your hand, you value it more and you're better. You make better decisions. Okay, I'm gonna say it again. When you know your numbers, whether it be you call it a budget, you call it a spend plan, you call it cash flow, when you know your numbers and you know what's in your hand, you're able to empower yourself and your home, your household, in such a way that you'll be better off in the future. See?
A lot there. We're down to about the last 10 minutes, give or take. So what I want to do is speed up. I'll talk a little bit faster. But first of all, the savings of the 270 or even the 500 that the person was trying to pay off in 5 months, they may or may not have had that money. And so if they had to work overtime to get the money to pay on all these bills, then that's one scenario. And what the consolidation does is it makes it to where you've cut the 500 that you needed to pay all of them in half down to 230, below half. So now you've got only $230 that you have to get to keep your, to keep the bill paid. And you only have one bill. And if you only have one bill of 230 and not 10 creditors that you got to worry about all the time and they fall through, you're gonna slip up on them. You're going to hurt your credit. The advantage to what we just talked about is you get rid of it all at one time. You're starting on the right path. And then you look at the $230 that you need and you decide if I got to work a little bit of overtime. But what you probably would be able to do instead of overtime is look at your budget and make some choices to where I can find $230 in the way that I spend money, that if I cut back and get more disciplined, I won't even have to work overtime. Now you're it's manageable for you to attack your problem. And so there's so many ways. Now, I want to tell you one real quick that you just brought up. I've been in forbearance on my first mortgage during the whole pandemic. That came as a godsend to me to be able to stop making my first mortgage payment. I can talk at great length about it. They add the whole payment, including the interest, onto the principal. And so you end up in a much worse situation than you were. And you don't want to stay on forbearance forever. But you know what? If you have to, you have to. You just have to accept that. So I did. But I did this one thing. I put myself on a automatic savings program in an investment account during the very beginning of it. I said, you know what? If I'm going to be relieved of my first mortgage payment indefinitely, I took $500 and did. I learned what dollar cost averaging is. And next week we're going to get into insurance. I think we're going to have to get into investing sooner than later, but next week we're going to do insurance and then we'll lead ourselves into investing because there's a link between buying insurance and investing. And so bottom line though is I saved $500 a month into an investment account and the market soared during the time that I had my money coming in and they went up almost 27%, I think. So, but here's the beauty of it. I knew that in July, I went on Social Security. I've been waiting for a number of years to do that. And I knew that I would have to do a consolidation debt. So what I've done is I was prepared for a circumstance that I didn't know about. My $500 a month grew over 18, 19 months, and it went up 27%. So it became beautiful for me. What I did was I took $2,500 out and got a lot of my bills cleaned up because I'm refinancing now. So they're getting ready to do credit reports on me, everything else, credit checks. But But here's one that came out of nowhere. And I'm just thankful that I had the money in reserve because of that $500 that was automatic, exactly like you said. And some people said, well, maybe you ought to just pay that $500 down on your credit cards. And I said, I'd like to, but I want to have it so where I can use that funds for more of an emergency because I didn't have a good emergency fund. Well, here's my emergency as it relates to my refinance. I don't know anybody that knew this. I just learned it through my refinance. When you're on forbearance, you cannot refinance until it's a federal law, until you have made three mortgage payments off of forbearance. And that came as a shock to me. And I'm helping other people with their refinance these days. And when I learned that from a mortgage broker, I was like, what? He goes, oh, yeah, Steve, you know, you can't even get a refinance until you're back on your first mortgage off of forbearance and got three payments made. So I didn't know what I was going to do. And then I spent a couple hours talking to my mortgage company last week. So here's what I'm doing. I'm off of forbearance in July. I'll make my August payment. And then by the time my new lender has approved my loan, which will happen, I'll have the three mortgage payments done over barely a 45-day period. It takes about 45 days to close a refinance. So, but I didn't have the money to pay. I couldn't go off forbearance because I didn't have the first mortgage payment out of my current income. I didn't have it in my checking account. My cash flow budget for the next couple of months doesn't include picking up that mortgage payment. I thought the refinance was going to take it out. So what I ended up doing was I'm drawing money out of that savings program and I'm making my mortgage payment, my first one. If I need money, I might be able to make my second and my third, but it's all there if I need it, all three payments. And so that's managing my credit, managing my debt, managing my refinance. And so I have a whole life of having to go through this very close because I've been in serious financial situation because of my illnesses. I've had a lot of downtime and 44% of the people that have my kind of incurable cancer go bankrupt. But I didn't want to go bankrupt. So here's my last thing I want to say in our lesson on debt. And we can pick back up on it some more next week because debt and insurance all go hand in hand. Johnnie, here's what I want to tell you about debt and moving our lives forward. You can consolidate. You can restructure things. But at the end of the day, if you don't have income to cover whatever it is that you restructure, it's going to catch up with you again. And so the one thing that we've left out today, though, that I apologize, it's getting a cosigner. And I teach the value of a cosigner. Now, if you can't get a bank loan, and you're a person that's got bad credit and just can't get a bank loan, you have to look closely at friends, family, that believe in you and trust you. It's back to the initial lesson of being able to have people trust you for what you say you're going to do. And if there's somebody that loves you and believes in you and trusts you, even though you're on hard times and is willing to co-sign, that's a tremendous obligation on their part because your payment that you're going to incur on the new loan or the debt consolidation, they're liable for it the exact same as you. If you don't make the payment, it affects their credit. It's their debt also. So if you've got somebody that can step to the line and help you do that, then you can work out your credit. And the one thing that I encourage everybody is become a trustworthy person, or you're not even going to be able to get a bank loan, or you're not going to be able to get a cosigner. But if it wasn't for a few people in my life that love me, that trust me, to have co-signed for me when I've gone through incredibly difficult circumstances, mostly health related, I wouldn't be here teaching like I'm teaching right now. And so here's what I'm going to tell you. And I'll give this one as quick as I've ever done it. Let's say that Uncle Steve co-signs a $5,000 two-year payment, the one we just talked about, consolidated somebody's debt, like a nephew or somebody. And they ask me, and they don't really even ask me. I volunteer and said, I'll co-sign for you. I'll help you get out of debt. We'll help manage your debt. We'll get you in strong position. And we do that. Well, that person respects me and loves me so much. And I've done this. That person respects me and loves me so much that they're going to make daggone sure that they don't miss a payment. They're going to finally settle down and go, I made an obligation to Steve, and I've got to honor that. I'm not going to let Steve down. So they make every single payment. They learn to control some of their habits where they're wasting too much money on entertainment or frivolous things. At the end of the 2 months, 2 years rather, that nephew, he's paid off that loan. He gets it in the mail, comes over to my house unannounced. I open the door. My nephew's standing there with the biggest smile from ear to ear on his face. And he says, Uncle Steve, guess what? And I say, what's that? And he goes, I got the loan paid off. Here's the satisfied note. And he goes, thank you. Thank you so much for believing in me. And I hug him and I say, I got to tell you something. I believed in you before you even believed in yourself. I never doubted for a moment that you were not going to miss a payment on that loan. I knew you were going to make every payment. That's the kind of life that I want to help people embrace, is to help other people, have people believe in themselves when maybe they didn't before, become trustworthy. And if you can be that person, you will have good credit for the rest of your life. Johnnie, you want to close the show, please?
Wow. That's an amazing place to move forward. What I would like to say is that listen to the show a couple times, because there's a lot of things in between that we're saying. Don't want to take it lightly. Make sure you apply it to your life. And then there's actually two thoughts. One is okay, so if you ask somebody to co-sign for you and there's been some dynamics before, whatever that means, then don't be offended if a person, because you don't know their situation, whether they say yes or no, but be a person of your word. And it's very important, because when we talk about being enslaved to debt, coming back to what we were talking about, debt, being enslaved to debt, when we say the word enslaved, it is about to control someone else's actions, thoughts, or emotions, or life completely, right? So when you look at that, remember that you can be enslaved by a lot of things, whether it be technology or anything. But the biggest thing that we're referring to is debt. We do not want you to be enslaved by debt. And so the tips, the tricks, the information that we provided is to help you step out so that you can step into your next level of greatness. So you can step into all that's before you, because there is greater ahead for you. However, remember that every decision you make matters. You being a person of your word matters, because it allows you to better move forward at a faster pace. It costs you something to get in debt. It didn't happen overnight. And it's going to cost you something to get out. It's not going to happen overnight. However, it is worth it. It is worth it, because it impacts every area of your life. Steve?
Johnnie, what a beautiful close. Credit is about character. It's about trust. And with that said, I'm looking forward to next week's episode in this series, where we talk about using insurance and having insurance, because it's just going to keep right on going, trying to help people have a better life. Johnnie, thank you. God bless you. Everyone, God bless you. Have a wonderful week, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you, and have a great week.